That's the plan of God. God created all men equal. But due to this thing that's called racism, my God, my God.
Louisiana has a lot of secrets, and it's time to unveil these secrets. It's time for the world to know what happened to the African-American population, why we're still in this position that we are in.
To grow up never hearing about any of those things, I think it's kind of a tragedy in and of its own life.
This experience has taught me that the dead speak when they're ready to tell their story.
How much do you really know about your past, your family's history, and the things that happened in your hometown? Thanks for joining us for WDOC's History and Hope, Our Hidden Past. I'm Christina Watkins. Today we are taking an in-depth look at two moments that shaped Louisiana, moments that are still relevant today. The St. Bernard Parish Race Massacre in October of 1868 and the Thibodeau Race Massacre in November of 1887. You'll meet some of the descendants of the victims who were killed. They describe the emotions they deal with to this very day and the questions they have about what happened to their loved ones. You'll also hear from two authors working to reveal their truth and bring justice to those families. Our story begins at the oldest Black church in St. Bernard Parish.
This church, honey, carries more history than any other Afro-American church in St. Bernard Parish.
The singing from inside First Baptist Church of Rhettville echoes throughout the small town in St. Bernard Parish.
Hallelujah.
Led by Pastor Raymond Smith for the last 31 years, this church carries a lot of history. His great-grandfather, the late Reverend Samuel Smith, built the church along Bayou Road in 1871.
The man in the picture is my great-grandfather. He was brought here from Charleston, South Carolina, at the age of 7 years old. And he worked as a slave boy on a Proctor's plantation right down here in Florissant, about 4 or 5 miles down the highway. At the age of 17, he ran away and he went to the Custom House on Canal Street and he enlisted in the Union Army and he fought in the Civil War. And when the war was over, he came back home and went back to the plantation.
Some would say it's a miracle Reverend Smith was able to build the church when he did. That's because just a few years before, there was a dark time in St. Bernard's history, a moment many don't often talk about. It was in October of 1868 after the Civil War when freedmen gained the right to vote. There was a presidential election between Ulysses S. Grant and Horatio Seymour, which ultimately would decide the fate of Reconstruction in the South. But right before Election Day, armed groups of white men came together to try and suppress those votes, leading to the St. Bernard Parish Massacre.
But my great-grandfather, he was here during that time. He was here, he was right in it, and God brought them through it. And from what I'm told about it, it wasn't nothing nice, baby. Massacre, you know what massacre is? No mercy, no pity.
Louisiana's 2020 Teacher of the Year and a National Teacher of the Year finalist, Chris Deer, detailed all of this in his book titled, The 1868 St. Bernard Parish Massacre, Blood in the Cane Fields. The history teacher and St. Bernard Parish native said during this time, freed people were dragged from their homes and murdered. The reports of those killed, he says, varies from 35 to more than 100 Black people. Those who survived, like Reverend Smith, did so by running to cane fields where they hid for days.
The sheer magnitude of this massacre is really what surprised me, and the implications that it had for not just St. Bernard Parish, but for Louisiana and for the entire country. To grow up studying history, getting a history degree, and never hearing about any of those things, I think it's kind of a tragedy in and of its own light. I think it's an injustice, and people need to learn and need to know what actually happened, the true history of their communities and the country as a whole.
Deere cites in his book how more than 60 freed people ended up getting arrested during the massacre, yet not one perpetrator was even questioned. To this day, there's nothing in the parish to show for the bloodshed, not a textbook, not a historical marker. Deere, along with the descendants of the victims like the Smith family, said they wish they knew more about what happened in October of 1868.
I wish I did. I most certainly do. I wish I did. There are some questions there that's unanswered. Chances are we'll never get the answer.
Deere continues to do research to get those descendants some answers. Back in 2018, he worked with First Baptist Church of Verrettville and held this memorial honoring those who died in 1868.
Smith, for opening your doors, thank you to the congregation.
The congregation also got the chance to hear from the parish historian about ways they can move forward.
Always remember that this abomination was born out of hatred and people sowing the seeds of hatred. And there is no excuse for it, and it can never be accepted. It's our fervent hope that through work like Chris's, we will see to it that this history never repeats itself.
Pastor Smith, who was now 83 years old, is on a mission. He and his family are working with the parish to learn more and to help the community. He's following in their loved ones' footsteps. He's turning to the sanctuary each and every Sunday to bring them peace and understanding.
My great-grandfather was an activist. He fought for freedom all of his life. The mantle is on me now. And I'm trying to carry on the legacy, trying to keep it, keep the lamp burning. In memory of all of those who pass on before us.
Anybody else need prayer? Sing like you for home.
And through Chris Deere's research, he found a headstone minutes away from First Baptist Church of Verrettville. But it's also surrounded by controversy. That's something we'll get to in a few minutes. But first,
this experience has taught me that the dead speak when they're ready to tell their story.
Another man played a major role in getting answers for descendants of the Thibodeau race massacre, how he too brought attention to our hidden past. Welcome back to WDSU's History and Hope, Our Hidden Past. Close to two decades after the St. Bernard Parish Massacre, more than 70 miles away, was the Thibodeau Massacre of 1887. My colleague, Emily Lane, spent the past few months looking into the history of all of this. And Emily, I know you found out so much from doing all of your research.
Yeah, Christina. Descendants tell me they recently learned about what their ancestor, Jack Conrad, went through before surviving that violence. But seeing how he overcame it filled them with pride as they discovered their place in his legacy.
We pour libations for Riley Anderson, Grant Conrad, Mercilyn Weldon, Archie Jones, Frank Patterson, Felice Pierre, Mahala Washington, and Willie Watson.
Eight names. A coroner's document listed eight names of those killed in the 1887 Thibodeau massacre. A former newspaper reporter for the Times of Home at Thibodeau wrote a book about the killings in 2017. Before that, he spent over a decade asking questions and collecting documents, aided by an archivist at Nicholls State University. But he says his work only scratches the surface.
My estimate is 30 to 60 dead.
These are the only victims that we have concrete evidence that they were killed.
Retired New Orleans educator Willetta Ferdinand's great-great-great-great-grandfather survived the massacre. His 19-year-old son did not. Another son was never heard from again.
We don't know if he ran into the swamp. We don't know if he was shot. We don't know if he changed his name and moved somewhere else. And there's so many spirits like that out here that we cannot account for. We don't know, you know, we just don't know.
While there's much to learn, her family and the community know more since DeSantis' book published. They know sugarcane workers, almost all of them black and mostly formerly enslaved, were targeted during a fight for labor rights.
In October of 1887, they laid down their tools. We said, we're not going to cut your cane anymore. And they began a strike.
The governor sent the state militia. A local judge ordered evictions. A vigilance committee formed.
Who vowed to protect Thibodeau from the Negroes.
And after two were wounded by gunfire, DeSantis says, word spread of an uprising.
That's when they began going door to door and, you know, hauling people out that they thought were leaders of the strike. They began shooting people. They began killing people.
Ferdinand's ancestor, Jack Conrad, was enslaved before he fought for the Union in the Civil War. After the South lost and he was freed, he moved back to Thibodeau to work as a sharecropper at a sugarcane plantation. He was living in Bacotown, where many formerly enslaved people lived at the time of the massacre.
Open up the door, shot Grant, killed Grant. That's Jack Conrad's
son.
Killed Marcelin.
The brother-in-law.
The brother-in-law, and then Jack Conrad got shot five times. He only wanted $1.25 a working day. For a working day, $1.25. You know, they wanted to find their humanity.
Two of those killed were in their 70s.
That just goes to show you the viciousness and the, you know,
the greed.
Yeah.
It was all about the economy. It was about race, too. But it also was about the economy, the money, the sugarcane being harvested at that time. Or they would lose money.
It was Conrad's pension application that told his own experience, along with depositions from other witnesses that included the first African-American voices telling the story of what happened. Ferdinand has always served as the family historian, she says. When DeSantis called her uncle to tell him about Jack Conrad surviving the massacre, she dug into the 180-page pension application and other research and wrote her own book. Each year since then, her extended family, some from out of state, gather at the site in Bacotown, Thibodeau, where, according to oral history, some of the bodies are buried.
It makes me really sad, and sometimes I really tear up when I come out here because it's like, what can you do? You can't do anything but pass the story on and hope that one day somebody will have enough money to come out here and penetrate this land and find their remains and put, you know, some kind of marker of reverence to it.
DeSantis says he received pushback after publishing articles and a book on the massacre.
I've been asked on more than one occasion, why do you want to rehash all this? And my response has always been because it was never hashed to begin with.
He first started researching after the local head of the NAACP told him about a massacre of black people had occurred, but no one knew much about it. While on assignment for another story, he asked an elderly woman about it. Her answer was the first confirmation he received.
She said, it was a long time ago, white men on horses came back to town and started shooting people. They were shooting black people.
He asked how she knew about it.
Her answer to me was chilling. She said, I'm not going to say anything else. I don't want to get in no trouble. And that was when I knew the extent of how the terrorism was that effective.
Thibodeau Councilwoman Constance Williams is the only black council member and represents a mostly black district. She says it's the city's poorest.
Most people were not aware of the massacre.
She says learning about it after DeSantis' book meant something to her.
Owning up to what has happened will make a difference to me, to my child, children, grandkids, it will make a difference.
Learning about Jack Conrad's suffering meant something to his descendants, too. And so did learning how he persevered, moving to New Orleans to start a new life here at the edge of the French Quarter, after being enslaved, after fighting in the Civil War, after being hauled out of his home and shot.
And that's why we praise him, we praise his legacy, you know, and we just want our family and other families to know too that, you know, there is light at the end of the tunnel.
There's still a lot more research that has to be done on this to really get it more of it, probably for longer time than I have years on this earth.
Right now, we're just looking at the kind of housing that my ancestors were living in when they were enslaved and when they were sharecroppers.
Louisiana has a lot of secrets, and it's time to, you know, unveil these secrets. It's time for the world to know, you know, what happened to the African-American population, why we're still in this position that we are in. This is where it started.
Conrad's descendants tell me their uncle bought land at the end of September, right near the spot where the victims' bodies are believed to be buried. Their uncle then donated it to a nonprofit that focuses on honoring the workers killed in the massacre.
One of the reasons why history is so important is because of the impact that it has today. We can't make the best decisions and the most informed decisions today if we don't have a knowledge of what actually transpired back then.
After the break, a history teacher born in St. Bernard Parish found a unique way to reach a younger generation. As time goes on, some parts of history, like the St. Bernard and Thibodeau race massacres, can be forgotten, sometimes even erased. One St. Bernard Parish native and Louisiana's 2020 Teacher of the Year is determined to teach the next generation about it. WDSU's Sherman DeSalle shares how the teacher's lessons plans are not what you'd see every day in a high school history class.
To grow up studying history, getting a history degree, and never hearing about any of those things, I think it's kind of a tragedy in and of its own life.
Chris Deere is passionate about teaching, especially the history of his hometown. Details buried for quite some time. His love for history started at a young age. His mother still teaching history in the parish today. So he was astonished as a teacher to learn what he was never taught.
The sheer magnitude of this massacre is really what surprised me, and the implications that it had for not just St. Bernard Parish, but for Louisiana and for the entire country.
He decided to teach about the massacre and its significance in American history. The information was well received by his students. Deere says even their parents were intrigued, especially when they noticed a little of themselves in the history.
Their last names were in the actual book, so they could see the history of their descendants. And I think that really brought it home for them. When I was teaching at Chalmette High, I used to teach the descendants of the survivors and the perpetrators in the same classroom, and they would be in groups together and not even know it. It was wild. Welcome to my series on the Reconstruction Era Massacres. This is probably gonna be one of my most meaningful videos, as this happened in my home parish of St. Bernard, Louisiana.
Chris uses TikTok to teach the history. His videos on resisting the Confederacy and Reconstruction massacres have garnered over 1 million likes. Many of his viewers are often left in disbelief.
The massacre silenced the black vote. At least 35 black Americans were killed and one white person was killed.
He believes this is why teachings on critical race theory, a method of understanding how racism has shaped policy in America, is so vital right now, and why there's so much resistance to it being taught at all.
The very same organizations that are pushing voter suppression laws are the very same organizations that are pushing these bans on critical race theory. I always, you know, ask people, if this was your family, wouldn't you want justice, or wouldn't you want that legacy to be known as well?
Whether on social media or a traditional classroom, this dedicated teacher is making sure people from all over know every hidden piece of American history.
One of the reasons why history is so important is because of the impact that it has today. We can't make the best decisions and the most informed decisions today if we don't have a knowledge of what actually transpired back then.
That was our Sherman DeSalle reporting. Deere also documented the Thibodeau race massacre on TikTok, and his page has close to 1 million followers. He focuses on what he calls, quote, unmarginalizing history. While he tries to educate, Deere says he cannot do it alone. That's where one St. Bernard Parish School Board member steps in. There's a lot of conversation and controversy around teaching children certain history in school. Some say leave it in the past, while others, like one descendant, believe it needs to be taught. Shelton Smith's great-great-great-grandfather was right in the middle of the St. Bernard Parish Massacre. He, just like his ancestor, is a school board member in the parish. Smith said he did not learn about history like this growing up.
It really hits home, and I think at some point, I think it is going to come out to where our curriculum will reflect some things that happened in St. Bernard Parish. It makes a difference to know those things that happened. It really would help us go further.
I want to bring back in my colleague now, Emily Lane. We know one of the main questions about both of these massacres is trying to figure out how many Black people were killed. For the Thibodaux massacre specifically, Emily, what is being done right now to get that answer?
Well, elders believe the bodies of the Thibodaux massacre victims are buried at a site in Bacatown. So in 2018, a group of students and professors from Tulane and the University of Louisiana at Lafayette started working together to confirm that. Project leaders say they need more money to finish what they already started. While that's on hold, more people in Thibodaux are acknowledging this dark time. In 2017, there was a mass for the victims. Catholic Bishop Sheldon Faub presided over it.
And I thought that by celebrating the mass, it would heighten knowledge, and with that knowledge, we might be better able to make decisions in the future that will not repeat past mistakes or past prejudices. So, and I say, and repeating past mistakes, I mean not respecting human life and human dignity.
Another topic of discussion here, descendants are pushing for historical markers at these massacre sites because they say the fight is still relevant today, from voting rights to fair worker wages. I mean, Emily, if you look at just what happened this past spring in the state legislature, it's one example.
Yeah, that's when lawmakers voted against bills to raise minimum wage above $7.25. Constance Williams, the only Black council member in Thibodaux, said she feels that's one example of why many in her community still struggle.
Job opportunities, housing, such as this, our parks, playgrounds, all of those things are a part of who we are. But it's not truly even in terms of a playing field.
And in St. Bernard Parish, the only physical reminder of the massacre is a tombstone for Pablo Sanfilippo.
Everything about this tombstone is inaccurate. First, it uses the word San, which means saint, so they were trying to deify him. They also claim that he was assassinated, which implies that he was of some importance, and they claim that it was the fault of carpetbaggers. Carpetbagger is a derogatory term given to people who came from the north to the south after the Civil War, and the date is just wrong.
So today we, of course, want to give a big thanks to the families who were so open and vulnerable with us and the community members who helped share their stories. To be part of this conversation on our hidden past, head now to WDSU.com. Thank you.